It is impossible to say it will be overemphasized when we talk about the resources Kaduna State is endowed with. So we've spoken, he and the MD has spoken about some of the mineral resources we have here. So we heard a bit about the metallic, non-metallic, and some of the gemstones that we have here in the state. I also heard from her about sports, which also taps into the youth. We have a lot of youth here. So the human development, that's another angle that we will definitely discuss shortly. Right now, I would like to call on some personalities here with us for a panel session where we will discuss ease of doing business reforms, sustaining Kaduna State as being number one here in the country. First, I would like to invite the ES Executive Secretary of Kadipa in the person of Khalil Noor Khalil. He's a great mind, and he has proven to us time and time again that age and size isn't a criteria for greatness. So please, a round of applause for him one more time. Next, I would like to call on is the Chief Registrar, Kaduna State High Court, Mr. Murtala Zuberu. We'll be hearing from him as well. Also, the Project Manager, PBEC and EBS, in the person of Ayokunu Ojeni. I believe I got that right. Don't go to bother. So please welcome. And last but not least, we'll have, she just spoke, we just heard from her, but she'll come back again. The president and CEO of SWA Sports, Ms. Aisha Shoaibu. Please, thank you very much. At this point, I'll be handing over the microphone to the moderator, the ED Center for Trade and Business Environment Advocacy, the person of Mr. Leonard Otuoni Ubaja. I hope I got that right as well. Okay.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone, my distinguished panelists, and of course the audience. So this morning we're going to be exploring the issues around ease of doing business, how Kaduna State has reached where it is, and what more do we need to do to maintain the momentum. And my panelists have already been introduced, so I won't go into that. So I'll start with the MD. By the way, thank you for having us here. All right. So I'll start with you, sir. So we're seeing what is happening, and you know the fame of Kaduna, we say, has gone abroad, or how the state has maintained the number one position on subnational ease of doing business in Nigeria. And you know, this has been on for quite some time. So how do you think you need to sustain this? What do you think Kaduna State needs to do to keep just being there at the top?
Thank you very much, Leonard. Once again, good morning, everyone. You know, you see, sustaining reforms, and you mentioning that we're number one. When we were forming this panel, we said sustaining Kaduna State being number one. I then now put Ayo, which in Pebek, they ranked us as number 14 or 12. So I was like, let me put him intentionally to spite Pebek, you know, in terms of the positioning. But what we're doing now in Kaduna State is, you know, His Excellency and his administration has done an amazing job. You know, we sat down, we digitized, automated a lot of all the MDAs, and even the other arm of government, CR, will be able to expound more on that. What we're doing next now is to ensure we sign the Ease of Doing Business Charter at the main summit on Saturday. Right. This will get all the MDAs to further commit in the next 4 years as to reducing the time, days, and costs and procedures it takes for you to get your permits and license. That's on the one hand. On the second hand is we try to ensure all reforms are institutionalized in Kaduna State, so they're established by law, similar to Kadipa and Co. What we want to do going forward, of course, is you know, to continue to host these Ease of Doing Business Committee, where myself, the likes of CR, other MDAs, sit down every week to hash out investor challenges, debottlenecking all the issues that businesses have, and so on and so forth. So these institutional reforms that we've had are part and parcel of what this administration is doing to sustain these reforms going forward. And I feel if we continue this into the next administration, which we're very confident about, you know, Kaduna State will not just be number one, but we'll be able to beat Pebek for ranking us number 14. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, you know, I'm tempted to go into the into that issue of the World Bank subnational ranking and then the latest Pebek ranking. But I think I would avoid that temptation so that I don't put eye on the spot. Okay, but at least we know that from the World Bank subnational ranking, Kaduna remains number one. Oh, yes. Great. I think that's great. That's wonderful. Institutionalizing the reforms is something I take away from there so that we have continuity in what has been achieved. That's great. CR, sir, we understand the importance of the judiciary, especially when it comes to resolving commercial disputes. And I also know that Kaduna has been doing well in that respect. So what in your mind do you think the state has done and what more could be done in fast-tracking the resolution of commercial disputes in Kaduna State?
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Before I go into that, let me allay the fears of the ES in relation to Pebek. I'm sure with the recent engagement we had with Pebek in Lagos, they have come down on that, their ranking. Am I right, sir? Yes. You see, from the judiciary's perspective, let me put you through what we have on ground. We have about 300 lower courts spread throughout the state, and they handle civil cases comprising the magistrate. When they sit at on civil matters, they are referred to as district court judges. We have the Sharia courts and the customary courts at the grassroots level, about 300 of them spread throughout the state. We have 18 high court judges. We have 5 cadis. We have 3 customary court judges. And all these courts entertain civil matters in addition to other matters that they also handle. Let me also put it on record that we have the Alternative Dispute Resolution Center within the building of the High Court in the headquarters. It has about 3 or 4 doors: arbitration, reconciliation, mediation. And recently we had the first ever settlement week in Kaduna State. We went around the marketplace and informed people that you can just move into the center with your dispute. And it was freely offered. We did it in such a way that you walk in or a matter can be referred from the court. We had, and it's still ongoing, it's free. You just move into the center, you lay your, the essence is to settle the simple commercial debts. And it's free. Now, we are having a recent engagement with the German Corporation, GIZ, yes, and the Presidential Enabling Environment, through which we have established what we call the Small Claims Courts in Kaduna State. It simply means courts that will settle simple commercial debts and liquidated demands. And the beauty of this exercise is that a case can be heard and determined from filing within a minimum of 1 day and a maximum of 60 days. We entertain lawyers, but they have to work within the confines of the practice direction. It's not more than 60 days from filing to conclusion. You talk about adjournment of cases. That when you go to court, they adjourn cases. In this practice direction for this small claims court, adjournment is only once, and you have to merit it before it is granted. Mm. So So these are some of the steps we've taken in the judiciary. We've already signed the Chief Judge of Kaduna State has signed the practice direction and the training manual. What we want to do now is to promote mass production of those documents, not only in English, Igbo, Hausa, Yoruba, and even Pidgin languages.
Wow.
We hope to receive more support from the government to be able to accomplish this. We're in the process of digitalizing the entire judiciary. The e-judiciary project has gone far, but we hope, like, not to talk of the magistrates, even some of the high court judges, they still write longhand. So if we can do something to even provide them, like the magistrates, if they can have this small tab, what do you call it? iPad, not the one below the iPad. The tablets, at least for research. We've gone into some collaboration with the Law Pavilion to enhance their research capabilities. We paid and they have installed some of the devices. Recently, the Law Compass has been launched in the Kaduna State. We've also engaged them to take some for the magistrates. So we hope we'll continue to receive some support to be able to deliver on some of these activities. Thank you.
Amazing. Amazing. This is, I'm sure Kaduna State is going to be setting a standard for national judiciary reform. Maybe I should apply for an honorary citizenship of Kaduna State after today. Thank you. Ayokunu, you're coming from the Central Coordinating Office for Ease of Doing Business in Nigeria. That's the Presidential Enabling Business Environment Council. And I would like you to speak specifically on what role do you think data can play in driving ease of doing business in Kaduna State?
Thank you, Leonard. I suspect it's Khalil, my brother. All right. 2 years ago, I stumbled on a cover by The Economist, and they tagged data as the new oil. And the reasons are not far-fetched. What gets measured gets done. Data shows you, I mean, just the way I believe data spoke to what Kaduna's position is now. My brother didn't mention that 4 years ago, we were in Abuja celebrating Kaduna as number one. So I believe that in the next ranking, we are very hopeful that Kaduna would return to its rightful place. So data is pretty, very important. If you don't know who your citizens are, you really can plan for them. In the South, there's this concept called Owambe, where people just stumble on patterns. How can you adequately cater for a number you don't know? Right? So the same thing goes for governance. If you don't know your citizens, if you don't have a 360-degree view of your citizens, it becomes very difficult for you to plan and to address their pain points. So the challenge really is to build a structure and system such that the data that will help us gain the insight to solving this problem, so that we don't walk in the dark and grope in the dark. So I think the Kaduna is, it's on the right path. Yesterday, I had calls to visit kaduna.business, and I know that I cannot register business premises online. And those are important data points. We tied that with taxation, tied up with the lands. I know amazing work has been done in GIS. We will be able to get a 360 view, and I'm sure that in a not-too-distant future, we'll begin to reap this new oil that data can only give. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I like the idea of the online business premises registrations and all that. Aishan, by the way, thank you for that great presentation on sports development. Indeed, those are the kind of things we need to do when it comes to empowering the young people and creating economic value. Thank you very much for what you're doing in that space. Now, as from your practical experience in business in Kaduna State, what do you think are those practical challenges you faced in doing business in Kaduna State? And if they've been resolved, kindly let us know how they've been resolved.
Well, thank you for that question. I've always said that access is really the main issue when it comes to businesses in Nigeria in general. Access to funding, startup infrastructure, access to talented and capable people. You know, as somebody that has been doing this now for 6 going on 7 years, startup infrastructure is just absent, and most people don't know exactly where to begin as far as technical know-how when they want to start businesses. There's also the issue of increased cost of running a business at the moment. I believe inflation is at 20.9% now, which is a 3% increase from just a year ago this time. And there's also the security concerns. Just yesterday, outside of one of my business operations in Abuja, a man was shot dead. So these are issues that are actually being faced by businesses on a daily basis in Nigeria now. And then, of course, there's the infrastructure gaps. But then you look at Kaduna State and what it's been able to do in the last 6 years of just creating a more conducive business environment for businesses to thrive. And you were saying, you know, my experience is running a business in Kaduna. I'm actually not running a business in Kaduna because I've been running away. Sorry, yes. Because
you need to bring her back to Kaduna.
No, but that's the thing, exactly. Like, there's been so much progress, there's been so much development, and just driving through Kaduna between yesterday and today, I've seen the changes. You know, it's visible, and it's just so impressive, and it's so commendable for this administration and Kadipa. So I'm definitely committing to setting up a business now in Kaduna because I just have to, right? So, I mean, those are the issues faced, but, you know, with states like Kaduna committing to development and creating that supportive environment for businesses to thrive in, you have no other choice but to make that sort of investment in this type of environment.
Thank you. Thank you. Digi, you know, well, I've got you an investor, first of all, so I'll come for my commission. Good. So she talked about some of the challenges. You know, she talked about the entire startup ecosystem, you know, access to skills, access to funds, especially skills. I think it's very critical in Nigeria. How is the state, Kadipa being the lead agency, addressing the issues that businesses face like this? How do you interact with your customers who are the businesses?
You know, Leonard, what we do in Kadipa is we strive to be a world-class investment promotion agency. We have done the peer review learning with our mates all over across the nation. We realize we're far ahead, so we said we won't stop there. So we're now benchmarking ourselves to IPAs across the world. So when we're doing peer review learnings, we do with the likes of Rwanda, Ghana, South Africa. We're doing one with Estonia next. So all it entails is you need to just be a responsive agency. You need to be approachable. You know, it's like His Excellency was saying this morning on Channels TV. We need to reverse the mindset and orientation, right? We are public servants, okay? We are not to dictate to the public itself. So when businesses like Aisha's business come in, they are the ones to dictate to us what policy should be like, what exactly they need. All we need to do is to listen, provide the enabling environment, and government should back up. It's a very easy thing to do, but like with many easy things in Nigeria, very hard to implement. So what we do is we institutionalize these things, right? We host business breakfast quarterly, monthly. We have all these interactive sessions with our investors. If you reach out to us online from any any social media interaction, you can get, we've had like, what, about $1 million, $2 million of deal flow from social media alone. It works for us. It has been working. So we feel all we need to do is to continue to become more responsive, more reactive. We need to be more proactive as well. So we have instituted what's known as aftercare services, where we go out every Friday, just randomly. We take the whole database of businesses in Kaduna State and we randomly just visit them. Go sit down, ask, what are your problems? What are your challenges? What does the state government need to do to give you the enabling environment? Are we doing the right thing? What about policy and feedback and so on? So all in all, it's been good. We'll continue to, you know, double down on what we're doing. And we just hope that businesses continue to remove this mindset where the state government is an enemy. We're all partners in progress here. And so far, so good. I think this administration has done an excellent job. Thank you.
Yeah, I think I must join you to commend the administration and the work you're doing, really. It's, like you say, most things in Nigeria, we think they are rocket science. But if public servants really present themselves as public servants, then they will serve the same people that have been the government. Okay, I pretend to have a very loud voice. Okay, great. Fine. So I can, what, looking at this, you know, you may not be intimidated, you're Pebek, but for some other person coming from another state not doing as well, the person may be intimidated. But you being Pebek, being the custodian of, you know, all that is good about ease of doing business reform, I'm sure you still think there are some things Kaduna State can do better, you know, to keep improving.
Absolutely. The journey to improvement is, it's never ended. But I must say that Kaduna is definitely on the right path. I think the little bump from first to the current position, it's going to be temporary, because we engage with a lot of states across the country. And one can confidently say that Kaduna is easily among the top. But in tying up all the things the state is doing, small claims courts, you have CFOs being issued promptly, all those things. One important piece that I think it's important to do in the short to medium term is the position of automation. How do we really make one-stop center work in practice? So from anywhere I am in the world, I mean, the entry point is that you can communicate with me on social media. The real place, probably what you would call utopia, is that, not utopia, because that would be a false dream, where we should really get to is seeing how, from the comfort of our homes, we can actually do what typically is the G2B or G2C type of business. How can I initiate, start my company registration, business premises, get a tax and education number, get the state identification number if possible. I mean, essentially what my colleague has said about the startup infrastructure, making it easy for people to, I mean, at the dead of the night, you have an idea in your brain and you just get onto it and you can set up the things that are required while the iron is still hot, right? So that automation piece, I mean, just let's look at a case in point. What you typically take days to do, let's say I need to register with a government agency. Sometimes you need to go pick up fiscal form in some office.
Yeah.
Can I do this online? And if I'm able to do it online, the next thing is that, can I get the payment receipts online? Well, the payment advice online. And when I get the payment, I'm like, can I make the payments? I know, of course, because I was a Kaduna business yesterday. I know the work has started, but we now need to move beyond having an oasis of development to making the entire city, entire business-wide, entire businesses enabled by technology. The lower hanging points have been done. We're not getting to the harder part. And it's not just for Kaduna as a state. Even at the federal level, we moved 39 places, aggregate on the World Bank doing business. Yeah. The low hanging fruits, now we are getting to the harder part where you need to come up with structural reforms. But I'm sure that Kaduna has the guts to get it done. Just on our way, we're speaking of our courage, just the leadership has been.
Yeah.
I mean, the fact that my brother is even the executive secretary speaks to the foresight and the courage within the administration does its business. So it's just a question of time. I believe the vision is clear. And I know that in a few years, Kaduna would, again, not just be number one in Nigeria, but would easily rank among the best in the world. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll come back to you, CR. You've reeled out a whole lot of reforms that are on the way. You know, could you give us two things? Number one, the timeline. What reforms do you think we should expect, say, in the next 2-3 months, you know, to come on stream? Then there's an important issue that keeps coming to my mind. You know, when you talk about your small claims court and all that, can you share with us briefly what your enforcement mechanism would be? How would you enforce judgments coming from that court? You know, would it be police, the normal belief system and all that? How do you think that's going to work?
Yes, let me start from the second leg of your question. The small claims courts are specialized courts. They are meant for simple debt recoveries and liquidated money demands. Like I said when I started talking, that we've produced the training manual There is a training manual, and the training is going to be all encompassing. All the actors in that court will be trained. There are going to be specialized beliefs for enforcement. Everything is specialized. And that is why you just have to find a way to work within the confines of the procedure. That is the law. If you come with technicalities, it means you don't belong there. Then you leave. Then on the other aspect, I want to break, I don't know whether the ES is aware, but Pepek is here. When we had the recent engagement in Lagos, I was made to understand as soon as the courts take off and we're able to go into publication in the website, we'll be, Kaduna said, we'll be able to access $1 billion.
Billion?
Yes. Am I right? Yes.
Well,
yes. Once we go into publication in our website, and we give them the case management flowchart of the workings of the small claims court, then we'll be leaning towards accessing the one. And that's what I'm interested in. Yes.
I like that. Yeah, Ayotunu, do you have anything to say to that?
Well, just to say, what can I say after the CR has spoken? CR is extremely very optimistic. No, not even optimistic. It's very, very bullish about the amount. Yes, some money is coming in the realm of some dollars.
Million or billion?
Certainly not billion. I'm sure that's right. Well, over 3 years, the state's judiciary can get as much as $4 million to be able to push some of the work we're doing. This is some work we're doing with the World Bank. And the state, in the next 3 years, can get potentially $52.5 million. So there's money on the table. The incentive is there. And I believe we can push and get the prize. Thank you.
Yes, Lies, that I, yes. Yes, I saw you signaling that you should write it down, you know. Okay, that's great. So that's under the World Bank and SEBA project, encouraging reforms, incentivizing reforms at the subnational level. Okay, Asha, I'll come back to you. You know, you in the whole scheme of things, we understand that sometimes the challenges that the young people and the women face when it comes to doing business could be different from the normal challenges. Do you think you want to highlight to us some of these challenges you think are peculiar to women or to young people?
I think it goes back to what I said about startup infrastructure and technical know-how at the beginning stages. So Ayo reminded me of something now when he said automation and taxes. One of the biggest achievements, in my opinion, of the Buhari Osinbajo administration is that they were able to enable the automation and ease of tax remittance through the Tax Pro platform online, which for me personally as a business has really benefited, you know, us. From when I think of having to physically go to offices in the past, and that's just hell, and nobody wants to go through that. And when you talk of women and youth, these are not things that when you're as an SME, you're able to even understand in your first, second year. And you already know how it works as a startup. You don't survive your first 2 years, you probably just won't survive after that, right? So that was a very important thing. But there's also the regulatory boards, right? When I think about the FCT, for example, as someone that has a physical location in Abuja, we have AMAC, and that's the Abuja Municipal Area Council that are meant to regulate the operations of
businesses. I don't like them.
Exactly. They're very frustrating, right? But this is an agency that is meant to actually develop and grow and lead to the sustainable, you know, growth and progression of your business, because you're remitting fees, you're paying fees to them. But I personally haven't really seen the benefit of that remittance. And these are people that come and they frustrate and they tension. And as a startup, as an SME, this can really force you to just exit and give up, right? So there is the responsibility of the ministry to look at this agency and similar agencies and you know, just hash out exactly what it is that you're doing with these fees that businesses, because you're paying taxes, you're paying fees to regulatory boards that are meant to help with your growth and development, but nothing's happening, right? And then there's also the issue of scale, which is a big, which still goes back to startup infrastructure. We don't start SMEs with the intention of scale. In Nigeria, we don't operate like that mentally. We start businesses because we need immediate rewards. And by the time we don't see those immediate rewards, business packs up. When you add the economic instabilities as well, that just adds to the whole mess. So scaling is something that the government can really play a part in helping when it comes to SMEs. And it's fantastic, by the way, that Kaduna has been able to get the Olams and the Dangotes, but an enabling environment for small businesses is just as important. Supporting small businesses is just as important, right? And by the government opening up their doors and saying, listen, we're ready to partner with you, where we want to partner with you, right? They've created an opportunity for themselves to generate their internal revenue to, you know, create more opportunities for growth, because other businesses would see this support and they would want to come and, you know, put down that investment as well. And then for the businesses, you can offer incentives as well. You can offer tax incentives, whatever it is, just to enable that participation between government and private sector. So, you know, as far as the responsibility of the government to ensure that there is that support and growth of SMEs and the success as well, given the economic instability of the country, these are ways that the government can step in and say, listen, we don't mean to frustrate these SMEs. We're putting policies in to help them grow sustainably. And we're also opening doors to more of them to just to come, you know?
Great. Thank you. Yes, we'll come back to you. You know, this investment promotion is like it's like a circle, you know. So you want to get investors, you do what you need to do to get investors. But to retain investors is another thing. And then you need to retain existing investors so that they become your testimonial to existing to potential investors. Could you walk us through your aftercare services? What you do already existing in the states, they're already running their businesses in the state. I'm sure there are a few investors seated here today. So I'm sure they would like to know what do they benefit?
A lot. Okay. Like I mentioned already, it feels like I'm answering the question. That I should give you a court for facilitating Aisha coming in. We don't collect commissions, so you will not get anything. I'm sorry. Game that we run. Clean operation.
Okay.
So I'm sorry. You can go to Lagos or somewhere else and, you know, do
so that. You're a professional, no professional fees.
No, my friend. we operate really is just to ensure that there are no costs or bottlenecks for investors coming in. You know, like I mentioned, the BRE, the Business Retention and Expansion Program that we're running, essentially consists of physical site visits, ensuring that you're reactive. So what that means is we have an aftercare officer, an entire job description. We have an individual that does basic customer care services for investors. So it's a lot of follow-ups, right? You know, with the likes of Chima here, who is a very, you know, well-known businessman in Kaduna State, one of our star businesses here. It is up to, if Chima has a problem, he knows he can reach out to me. Whatever it is I'm doing, I'll stop it, and all investors are top priority. So even that political will, showing investors that we are committed, we do have a program. Now, what I'm worried about is, as an ES, as Khalil, I shouldn't be the person that they call. I need to institutionalize it. That should be a legacy that you leave in the agency. Because then if I leave and he's trying to reach out to me and I go, it's not me, it's Ayo that is the ES now. It doesn't make any sense anymore. So what we're trying to do now, you know, with the board is to create an actual business retention environment framework that we're working on. This document will serve any other ES, any other management team that comes and picks up the book. You just implement these things. You know, I think really, that's about it. You know, physical site visits, being more reactive on social media, having a customer care service, having an actual officer that handles all these things. And it's pretty, it's like you said, it's very busy. Nigeria is very funny. You do the most basic things, and that just shows that you're achieving things. It's quite mind-boggling to me. It's quite counterintuitive. If we get praises when we're doing our job that we're meant to do, I always tell my team, calm down, calm down. It's what you're meant to do. Stop, don't let it get to your head. Thank you.
I like that. I like that. That's the kind of orientation that we need to move the country forward. I'll come back to you, my panelists, for your last remarks. But before I do that, I want to go to Chima. Please, Chima, can you tell us something about doing business in Kaduna State?
You have my mind. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I wonder why he chose me to do this.
The star
and the fact is, I don't like microphones, but just like I'm saying micro manner. So I don't know why he's giving me this. Well, I've been here for 25 years. I came in as a youth core member, and I can comfortably say that Kaduna is actually my home. In my family, we have a few entrepreneurs. Amazingly, we are the only ones up north here. Other ones are somewhere else over there. And then every week or so, we talk about the ease of doing business. There was a particular day my brother called me on a Monday. He just came to his business. And he saw about 15 men. No, ask her. He thought maybe they were customers. I said, oh, we're from this agency, we're from that agency. He said, on a Monday morning, by 8 o'clock, you're already seated in my office waiting for me. So we don't experience such things in Kaduna. That's why somehow, if I tell them about Kaduna, if not for the insecurity part of it, I'm sure a few number of them, like, they would have actually moved back to Kaduna. I mean, to come and stay with us here. Like, everything you want to do, like, we're one-on-one with Kadipa. Even before Khalid came, I could actually call, oh, this is what we have, and the person will respond to it. So those are the things that actually make small businesses like ours thrive. But here now, okay, we just set up a school. There was a day one of the agencies actually mistook one of our properties for something else, and they tried to do something. And I quickly called Khalil. He was in a meeting with His Excellency. He left the meeting and came to the place and solved the problem within 10 minutes. As a matter of fact, if it was maybe in another state, I'm sure it might take about 2-3 days. By then, some harm would have been done. So I can actually commend him and his agency and the people around too. Because for having lived here for like 25 years, if I leave this state for a week, I always want to hurry back to Kaduna. In fact, to my hometown, they're as good as say, look, I don't belong there anymore. You know, because I'm like, the last time I flew in, like on a Monday, Tuesday, I was back. But like, even if I'm out of the country, I want to come back to Kaduna because of the people around and I would say for the business, you know, like when you have a home, home is different from like where you just go and sleep and all that. So Kaduna is home for us. My wife schooled at ABU, part ABU and then Maiduguri, but she treasures Kaduna so much. All investments we have are actually like majorly in Kaduna. And if you find out, like Abuja that is very close, you can't compare what they do there with what we do here. So you can actually reach each of the agencies and you can talk one-on-one with them. They're not there to rip you off. They're there to do their jobs. And they don't take undue advantage of people. So those are the things that small businesses like ours need to thrive. So I must commend them and commend everyone here for being part of our story. Thank you very much.
Thank you. You know, I like the part where he said they are not there to rip you off. Because what you realize, especially at the state level, most agencies are looking at how much they can get from businesses rather than supporting businesses to thrive. And I'm happy that Kaduna is doing it differently. And I would like to commend His Excellency and his team for making this happen this way. So I'll just go, just in about 1 minute. Your comments, or maybe some other person has a question or a comment to make. Okay, just in 1 minute. Can someone help me get this mic across to him? If you want to direct a question to someone, just direct it to the person. Otherwise, just make your comment.
All right. Sorry. My name is Mohamed Bello Buhari, and I'm directing my question to Khalid. So I believe that this expo is about business here, what you're having here. And my question is this, how is Kaduna State instilling human rights principles in a private sector, that is people running business here in Kaduna State, how are you making sure that they're respecting the human rights of the people around here in Kaduna State?
I don't know why this question is directed to me when you have the chief registrar right here.
Yes.
So I will say we are doing our best and we do all the legal checks and balances that is meant to be done. Then I'll hand it over to Sia.
You see, sir, there are provisions under the law whereby when there is any breach, you can take advantage of that provision and move to where you can get redress. That's why we have the courts. I assure you, we are on ground and we are doing our best to make sure that we do exactly what is contained in the law.
Thank you. All right, maybe we should start from Aisha. What are your last words for the audience?
Well, firstly, again, Khalil and your team at Kadipa, and of course, the governor and the state as a whole, I just want to, you know, show my gratitude for this platform, just to be able to speak on behalf of women, youth, and Arewa women in particular. And I also want to encourage my fellow women and youth to start businesses of their own. Are we or are we not satisfied with the development in Kaduna? You can answer yes or no. Yes or no? Yeah, so, you know, play a part in that development by starting businesses of your own. We need to break the cycle of inactivity in Arewa. We have so many issues that are impacting our region, and it actually starts with the youth. And the older generation are on their way out, whether it's from leadership or private sector. We have to fill in those shoes. And it's very good to see somebody as young as Khalil in his current position, among the many other youth leaders that I've seen here today. So please, step up to the plate, find the courage, find a mentor, get motivated, and start businesses and contribute to the development of Kaduna State and Nigeria as a whole.
Thank you. Ayo.
Thank you. Again, let me follow the tradition and most heartily thank Khalil for the kind invitation. I think the point that I like us to go with is to keep up the engagement with the government. Sometimes there's a depth of knowledge. We don't know everything in government, so it's important that you come with fresh ideas. Challenge where, I mean, if Kadiba says it takes 24 hours to get your business premises registration done, and if your experience is different, please, by all means, speak up. Because Khalil, on a daily basis, doesn't register business premises. Yeah. He would only know if you reach out. And if there's any good you also say, please, by all means, give a thumbs up. It's important that we keep the conversation open. And as we do that, I believe that our collective dreams as citizens will come into fruition. Thank you.
Yeah. See you, sir. See you.
Well, I don't know whether I also have to thank Kadiba, and I don't want to do it because we have three arms of government.
Yes.
He is coming from the executive.
Yes.
We have the legislature, and I'm coming from the judicial arm.
Oh, yes.
And it is one government.
Yes.
So I want to believe the thanks applies to me as well.
So, CR, thank yourself.
No, I want to thank them for thanking the government of Kaduna.
Oh, great, great.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. All right, yes.
Yeah, thank you very much. Let me return the favor. You know, Leonard, Aisha, Ayo, you know, for taking out the time to be on this panel. And for CR, you know, it's quite funny how Kaduna State government operates. You know, you see a 29-year-old with a CR, you know, 55, well, he's 55. He's quite young, actually. You're quite young. You know, no, it's true. You know, and when people come to Kaduna State and they see the way we interact and they go, small boy, but that's just how it is. When I'm in council, I'm not there as a 29-year-old. I'm there as ES Kaduna. What ideas do you have on ground? We have already moved from that thing where you're going, wow, this guy is young too. How are you delivering? What are you doing? How are you contributing to society and so on? And I think that's the mindset that His Excellency has put across for all of us. And it is key for us to be the next, you know, an inspiration for the next generation. Because we're not just here to, you know, be the ones that everybody keeps thanking or whatever. We're here to set the tone, set a legacy, and begin to think with the end in mind. What is the future of Kaduna that we're trying to see How do we get there, ask these difficult questions, and actually just roll up our sleeves and get to work? There's just no more time for talking. I don't think there's time for excuses anymore. And like my brothers here said that they don't feel like the business environment is favorable. So they take their names, please, and bring them to our, you know, agency on Monday. Let's hear what exactly it is. We want to challenge every single business. What is your problem? Is it that you cannot key in? If so, why not? What are the excuses? There's just no more time for excuses. And Nigerians are very, very good at making excuses. I always tell my team there's an excuse economy that exists and we need to assess it. But it doesn't make any sense to me. So I feel we need to put our heads down, watch, like Aisha said, how can you key into the state development plan? How can you contribute to society? We need to move away from being an extractive and rentier-seeking economy to actually adding value to the economy and being productive. So what are you doing today to advance society tomorrow? So invest in Kaduna State today, invest in the future. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
So I'll close this panel with a short story. You know, a few years ago, I think that was 2019, I was appointed by a state governor where I come from to work for him. And I said, okay, sir, I'll help you to work on ease of doing business. You know, that's what I have always done. Then I design my programs, I make my presentations, and he will ask me, is this what Kaduna State is doing? I'll say, yes, okay, approved. We're going to do this. So the selling point is, this is what Kaduna State is doing. And if that is what Kaduna State is doing, approved, we're going to do it. So on that note, I want to thank all of you for listening, and may God bless Kaduna State. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll go for a quick networking session, and that would last till about 2 p.m. So we'll have.